People from every walk of life have come in their thousands, and from right across the city and beyond. 8 years in the planning, this is an event most communities in Britain can only dream of. I'm here for the opening of a new building in Birmingham, and a very special one at that.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask Lala to unveil the plaque.
The opening of a grand new public library might come as something of a surprise. All round the country, budgets are being cut, libraries are closing. Some even say there's no place for libraries in this digital age. And yet here we are, celebrating the opening of a £200 million building, the largest public library in Europe. So, if this is anything to go by, maybe the library isn't dead. Maybe the library is being reborn.
I'll be exploring the building to find out what a library has to offer in the 21st century. And I'll also discover how artists and local people are coming together as a community to celebrate the arrival of this people's palace.
Good morning, welcome. It's Richard Wilford at breakfast, Monday morning, the 12th of August. Listening to BBC WM 95.6, the voice of Birmingham and the Black Country.
Back in August, I set off to visit the new Library of Birmingham. This is not a city people associate with attractive architecture. It's been described as a godless concrete urban hell.
So, Birmingham wants to get a new, glitzier image. The City Council's regenerating the city centre, and the new library's part of this massive, monumental rebrand.
So, it's goodbye to 60s concrete. And hello to the latest in design. Such as the 2010 Cube building, with its jigsaw-like shaped panels. And this crazy Selfridges building, with its surface of aluminium discs, which reminds me of a sequin boob tube. If Birmingham's recent past is anything to go by, the new library promises to be a statement building.
I've got to be honest, I'm a bit of a fan of post-war architecture, particularly the concrete variety, and not a great lover of kind of glitzy, iconic buildings. But I am ready to be convinced. Maybe this one will win me over.
First impression. Yes. Oh no.
I think it's quite unique and I quite like it.
Not very pleasing on the eye, I don't think.
I love it. I think it looks really fresh, modern.
Crikey, that is one bright building.
Not quite sure about the barbed wire exterior.
It looks like it should be in IKEA.
It's what I call loud shirt architecture.
I like the structure of it, it's really nice.
I just think it's too busy to look at. There's just too much going on.
I think it looks like a mosque.
I think it would bring a new style to Birmingham, and a lot more buildings should look like that.
Francine Huben from the Dutch architect firm Mecanoo is a design force behind the building.
So tell me, how did you reflect the character of the city, the Brummies? I mean, how does that come through in the building itself?
You feel it's a very young and energetic city, and with many identities, people come, and it's very colourful. So the idea is that it's really made for all these people. Bold and delicate at the same time, that's the way we try to make the building.
That sounds like the true character of the Brummie. Yes, bold and delicate at the same time.
Yeah.
It's a very strange shape. Can you talk me through the different layers?
We try to make it as compact and elegant as possible. It's a kind of dancing with all the different city scales. So this is connecting Centenary Square. That one is more overseeing the city, and that is almost overseeing the region.
Okay.
And from there on you see the beautiful hills of Birmingham.
So, what about the circles on the outside? I mean, is that a reference, a local reference?
We started with this idea that the heritage of the proud industrial city, with the steel industry, it's also linking to the 200 years of craftsmanship of the jewelry. It's also bringing unity. It's a kind of bringing everybody together, because that's why I call it a people's palace.
This isn't just a building designed for the people of Birmingham. Most of the £189 million has come from a loan to be paid back from public coffers. So is it worth it?
I think any investment or money put into libraries at the moment is fantastic.
Yeah, I think they have had their day. Really did.
I find most of the information I need on the internet at the minute, so...
I think they're still a bit important part of the this communal thing, getting the community together.
And at a time of economic austerity, what a bold step to take. Wonderful stuff.
I think it's cool.
Do you think they could have done something better with the money? Babies?
With the opening still weeks away, the locals still only have a vague sense of what their new library has to offer inside from the design plans. These reveal a vast 35,000 square metre space spread across 10 floors, including cafes, auditorium space, and even roof gardens. But I'm lucky enough to be getting a sneak preview inside ahead of the official public opening.
So the building is made like a journey. The whole experience is a journey of learning.
It's amazing how the building starts to unfold in front of you as you come through. Wow!
This is maybe the most iconic rotunda. Yeah. It's what we call the book rotunda.
Wow. It's huge, isn't it? You don't get any sense of this space when you're outside. And it's striking how different the character of the building is inside from out. I mean, outside, it is very flamboyant. Inside is quite muted and sober, and actually all the energy is in the spaces.
What you also see around this book rotunda, we made in radial system. So you're always orientated to the daylight.
You are, aren't you? Your eye just naturally draws
the panorama of the circles and the shadows.
Well, that means that also that you don't get that sense of enclosure that sometimes you get in libraries. You can always see the outside world,
can't you?
I mean, a library's roles change so fundamentally. It's a meeting place, it's a place to do many things as well as just read a book. How did you combine those roles in this one building?
I think what is nowadays so essential that there's many ways of studying and learning. There's a lot of people, students, they want to be individual, but be part of a bigger collective.
That's interesting.
We made all our study places, so you can sit here together on this table, or you can have your little own private room, or maybe come, because this is so beautiful.
Okay. But here, oh, wow, look at that, it's huge.
So you can sit here on the what we call the facade bench, being very individual, but at the same time dreaming, or maybe talking to somebody who's next to you.
That's interesting.
Almost romantic.
Yeah, little flirtations over the books. People are gonna fall in love here, maybe.
Yeah, and then they can go to the secret garden.
For a little tryst.
Yeah. It's not just the inside of the library that offers a new kind of space for local people. The building is helping create a special new district in the city.
A key vision for the new library is that it forms part of a cultural hub. So it's flanked on one side by the Symphony Hall. It shares foyer space and a new theatre space with the refurbished Rep Theatre there. And a short walk away, just over there, is the old art gallery. So that art and music and performance joins knowledge in a new shared space.
To reflect this, a new public artwork has been commissioned for the library's plaza. A sculpture to celebrate civic life, it will depict a real Birmingham family. It's the brainchild of Turner Prize-winning artist Gillian Waring, herself a born and bred Brummy, who's been working on the project with Icon, the local art gallery. The process to find a family began 2 years ago with a roadshow, inviting people to nominate themselves with a photo and a short family biography. No criteria was set. Single parents, extended families, and groups of friends put themselves forward. The idea being to explore what family means in today's world, especially in a city as diverse as Birmingham. From 370 nominations, a panel selected the Joneses as the winning family. Emma and Roma, two sisters who've lived in the city all their lives and are both single parents to young boys. Today, the Joneses are going to visit the site for their sculpture for the first time with Icon Gallery curator Stuart Tullock.
This is where the statue of you, the Jones family, will be. And the statue will be very similar to a work that Gillian did in 2007 in Italy. On a plinth, life-size, made of bronze. With this small plaque here that would be describing you as a family.
Wow. What would it say on there about us?
It'll describe you, I suppose, for people in the future, of actually knowing who you are and the idea of the project of how to represent the people of Birmingham.
Is there any idea of how the statue would be shaped, like the way we'll be standing or...?
Yeah, Gillian, that'll be from Gillian. We'll be thinking very much, and maybe with you as well, of how you feel comfortable.
It'll take several months to complete the sculpture, but for the Joneses, the reality is already hitting home.
We decided to enter the competition because we are a diverse family. Just to show being a single parent is a positive thing. We both were crying when we found out. We were so emotional. We feel so privileged and honoured for our children, for when they're old enough to understand it more, for them to be proud of themselves, because we're so proud of our family.
The real Birmingham family won't go on public display until 2014. But in the meantime, the library's opening day is fast approaching and staff are hurriedly putting in the final books. Faye Davis has worked as a librarian in Birmingham for nearly 25 years and is helping oversee the transition to the new building.
I hope I'm putting them in the right order. I know that's very important to a librarian.
You have to bring them to the front of the shelf.
I bring
them
to the front of the shelf. I'm always getting it wrong.
Always to the front of the shelf.
Always getting it wrong. So this is the last crate of books, basically.
Absolutely.
What a job it's been.
Enormous job. And obviously it's taken us a very long time. And the move started at the end of May.
How many books have you had to move?
I knew you were going to ask me that question, and an awful lot.
An awful lot, that many?
Yes, an awful lot. We've had about 1,000 crates a day, actually, moving out of the central library and into this library.
That is quite a house move, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely enormous.
Sometimes I get this impression in a library that somehow the books aren't really for you. They're some kind of, they're protected behind glass or something, but here they're out there. You just feel like you can just grab anything that you want.
I'm really pleased you've said that, because that was one of the fundamental principles behind the way that we've newly structured all of this. It was very much about self-service, being able to feel that everything was accessible, everything's intuitive, more intuitive than it was in the old central library.
I mean, nowadays, lending numbers at libraries are in decline. We can all get access to the internet, we can buy cheap books now. I mean, what role is there for a lending library now?
I mean, I have to be honest, issue figures, as we call them, lending figures, are reducing, so we're trying to reverse that. Yes, we have to move along with the times. We also have e-books. We also have access to all sorts of IT and technology. But in a lot of ways, the book is still very much at the heart of this library. And some people don't like to read Kindles. The physical object is actually what they want to get at. But as you've probably seen as you've been moving around the building today, it's far more than a library in the traditional sense, most definitely. It really, really will become a real hub of knowledge, of learning, of creativity.
Sort of brains of Birmingham.
Why not? Birmingham's created some amazing brains and we intend to continue with that.
You'll probably have a holiday, I think, when you finish building this.
When the library opens its doors, 10,000 visitors are expected each day. And they won't just come to borrow books. In the archives, conservators are getting ready to show off some of the library's greatest treasures to the public for the first time, including a unique collection of 60,000 magic lantern slides, first created for use in Victorian entertainment shows. Once stored away in back rooms, items like this can now be made accessible to all through new exhibition space and a specially created digital app. All in all, it's quite a building. From the archives to the beautiful book rotunda, right down to the rooftop gardens overlooking the city.
To be honest, I'm never going to like the outside of this building. It's just too brash and too glitzy. But the interior, wow, what a revelation. It's so generous and accessible and beautifully made. It's a real palace of knowledge. And in this age of austerity and cuts to the public sector, a true contemporary vote of confidence in the very idea of a public building.
It may be unique in Britain, but this library reflects a global trend. It's part of a new breed of so-called super library, designed for the digital age, popping up in cities around the world.
The public library in Seattle set the gold standard. I love its jagged shapes and bold presence. China's taking its digital role very seriously. Its building's designed a bit like a giant hard drive. In Stuttgart, their new library looks like a kind of glowing fortress of knowledge. I love this one. It's like a great glass pyramid, all the books piled on top of one another like a book mountain. And most futuristic of all is this one in Perugia. It's like a giant glass sort of flying saucer.
Libraries are undergoing something of a revolution in the digital age. But ever since the very first libraries were built 5,000 years ago, they've constantly adapted to changes in our society. In ancient times, libraries were revered as temples of knowledge and placed at the heart of the city near the public forum. By the 1700s, libraries were hidden away in grand private houses and palaces, the preserve of the elite, symbolizing wealth and privilege. 150 years later, free public libraries were born, imposing buildings worthy of their grand ideal to bestow knowledge on the masses. Before giving way in the welfare state era to post-war concrete buildings, speaking a new language of democracy. And now today, there's something of a power battle going on for the very place a library has in our society.
Thousands of people across the United Kingdom have been protesting about the potential closure of their local libraries.
We would like to protest at the widespread cuts to the library service taking place throughout Scotland.
We love our local libraries, yeah. We use them every day.
Organisers of the protest say they fear up to 400 will have to close in total. Council leaders say funding cuts mean keeping libraries open would put other services at risk.
Hi! Hello! My name's Michael Rosen, and I write books. And do you know, the very first book I wrote was called Mind Your Own Business.
Children's author Michael Rosen has played a key role in the recent Save the Libraries campaign. So does he think super libraries like Birmingham's are the shape of things to come?
I think super libraries are potentially wonderful. They're very, very exciting places. They can get hundreds of people in them. They can put on shows. They can create a buzz about books and buzz about knowledge. I guess it's a new kind of municipal pride. Now, there's an element of it that you might say it's a great big city council showing its wares, showing its power. Another way of looking at it is saying, well, if it cost nearly £200 million, what if that £200 million had gone into all the local libraries? Would you have 20, 30 jewels in Birmingham as opposed to one huge one?
What's this here? Yeah. Don't be cheeky, 6 o'clock nose.
Very good. If I'm in a family and we're thinking about, oh, we'd like to go to that Birmingham library, that wonderful library, well, everything, paying bus fares or petrol or whatever, you know, it's going to cost them, isn't it? And if I'm not very mobile, then I will think, well, maybe it's not worth the faff of going all the way in. So there's going to be various ways in which I'll think, maybe it's not for me. It can't be a substitute for the good local library with a professional librarian there. It's not a substitute. It's a wonderful add-on. It's like a huge, great treat, in that sense, for the people of Birmingham. But it can't be a substitute for the local library.
Birmingham Council has pledged to keep all 39 of its branch libraries open, but they are facing cuts in hours and budgets. But the opening of the new library has resulted in a complete closure of one very special building. John Maiden's 1974 Central Library, which, according to the council, has fallen into such a bad state of disrepair, refurbishment simply wasn't a cost-effective option. The brutalist building is held up by some as a classic piece of post-war architecture, but reviled by others, including Prince Charles, who once described it as more like a place for incinerating books. Here to capture its last days is Stuart Whipps, one of four local photographers documenting different elements of the library move for an upcoming exhibition.
I think it's a really important building to me personally, but also
in how it really embodies the kind of boldness of that post-war period. This was the largest civic library in Europe when it opened. The footprint that it has in the city, I think all of these things make it a really rich site.
What were you trying to tease out with the project?
Initially, just recording the space, you know, spaces, recording the building as it is, but also to perhaps raise some questions about the decisions that are made, you know, in town planning and kind of more widely about what we keep and what we don't. I've got some small versions of what the final things will be. They're a bit large, the actual ones. So,
A lovely bit of concrete. I love concrete.
I was keen to try and show just some of the core elements of the building. And I think this is a pretty iconic shot of what the library is. So this is where you see perhaps more of how it's been knocked around a bit, you know, and some of that vision of what it was has kind of changed as it's been used.
And the clarity's gone, hasn't it? Because all these kind of signages have gone in there in different way. Different facilities managers have come in and knocked it around and so on.
I mean, I sort of imagine that everything that has been put in since the day it opened has made it worse. So,
and a pot plant.
One of the other things I became interested in was the ways that people have tried to soften the building as well. So I've got this whole series of yuccas and various kind of plants.
Trying to make it more friendly somehow.
Well, you know, we think of brutalism. I thought there's something interesting about what that becomes when people inhabit it.
Despite repeated attempts by English Heritage to save the building, it's now set for demolition next year.
Will you shed a tear?
I will shed a tear. I think that regardless of my attachment to how it looks, which I do think it looks great, but it would be much nicer if we had these things coexisting and that you can tell that, you know, this thing happened and these decisions took place and that there's a building that is an embodiment of that.
Well, Birmingham's got a history of being sometimes a bit hasty. I mean, it demolishes quite willfully. It has throughout its history, hasn't it?
Yeah. The motto of Birmingham is forward. And above that motto on the coat of arms is a big hammer.
I mean, it's a bit like a kind of Stalinist approach to history, isn't it? You're kind of airbrushing out the mistakes from the past.
The great thing when you look at those old photographs from communist Russia, though, is that you can always see that there's something missing and they never quite feel right. And I think it's the same in a city, actually. If you just, demolish what you consider to be the ills of the past, you always know that there's something not quite right.
Not all history is being swept away. One special link to the past is being preserved in the new library's Golden Rotunda. The Shakespeare Memorial Room has been painstakingly moved panel by panel from the Central Library, which in turn took it from the city's original Victorian Library. Altogether, it's taken 3.5 years of building work to complete the new library. Back in May, when large parts of the building were still hard hat areas, preparations were already underway for the grand opening. Julian Day, the director of music spectacle group Supercritical Mass, has come to recce the library to start planning a performance for the opening ceremony. The piece will be a unique response to the architecture of the building, so he's here to sound out the acoustics.
This is a pretty extraordinary space. I don't think I've ever quite been in a space like it. Photos don't quite do it justice. It's actually much bigger than I thought, and the acoustics are a bit more surprising. Particularly as you get higher up in this rotunda, they really become very rich, and because of the circular nature, the echoes do some unusual things. I think this really offers a lot of potential.
The musicians will be drawn from across the city, and today Julian is rehearsing with students from the Birmingham Conservatoire.
So maybe just a long note, take a breath or two, another long note, pick a different note each time. It can be any note of your choice. We're still at a relatively early stage of devising the piece, and the work always emerges through the process of having workshops and get-togethers with the musicians. Just give me, like, your lowest comfortable A. I think there's a great sense of communal spirit among brass players. When using brass, we'll often use long tones that might be the length of players' breaths. And if they're all doing that at different times, you get these surging, breathing in and out sort of patterns. There's some big lungs over here. Nicely done.
My name's Saffron Ali. I play the euphonium. I've been playing it since I was 11 years old, so that is 14 years now. In the United Kingdom, there's quite a lot of heritage of brass bands. Being part of it is quite a proud thing for me. I'm quite intrigued in how it's going to sound in the library itself. It's going to be quite good.
As musicians prepare, the city readies itself for the big day. The time has come for the people of Birmingham to test out their new library as the building opens its doors for the first time. There's no shortage of interest. The queue goes around the block and continues all day.
It's great to be here at the moment when the architecture comes alive, when the public, the great British public, flood through the doors. It's like blood flowing through the veins of the building.
Kicking off the celebration is Supercritical Mass with its abstract brass performance of Together We Breathe. Meanwhile, across the building, people are already settling in. So what do Brummies think of their new space?
Lovely. Yes, I think it's done Birmingham proud.
I like the circular designs. It promotes the feeling of being able to look up. Well, not quite to the heavens, but you know
well,
what I mean.
Almost.
Yeah.
Reminds me of the Congress building in America, for some reason, the circles.
It's brilliant, yeah, I really like it. It's very user-friendly.
Oh, it's beautiful. I think it's so amazing. I love this especially. I love this outside bit with the balcony. It's really relaxing.
Nice children's environment to play and yeah, kids like it.
Every time we've finished a book and when we're coming back to pick another one.
It's for everyone, isn't it? And there's so much free things and everyone can get involved.
I've been in the library 10 minutes and I've had a nice chat with the lady here.
It's just a nice place to come and just chill out. And it's so big, you can be here all day.
It's easy to get sentimental about libraries, and rightly so. In what other building can you lounge about all day reading Tolstoy or take a break without even having to buy a cup of coffee? What other building celebrates civic life and brings a city together for a cause more noble than buying the latest trainer or the latest smartphone? This building does just that. It unites a whole people so they can become something bigger and better. For me, a successful, cohesive society depends on buildings like this.